Look at your neighbor and tell them that you're glad they're here this morning. Amen? A couple of notes. Just remember that our annual business meeting will be February. February the 15th. That's a Wednesday night at 6. This is something we have to do to fill our obligation to the state, since we're a corporation, and so I just incorporated as a church, so we have to have an annual business meeting. So I invite you to come out for that. Nominees, if you need, want to make a nomination, if you're a member of First Assembly, want to make a nomination, you can see any of the board members, and they'll give you one of these sheets to fill out, and you can drop it in the nominating box in the back on the book table or resource center. And your board members will have those for you. And so I just encourage you to do that. We'll leave that out till after tonight, and then we'll pick it up. And so if you want to make one, this is your last Sunday to do that. Amen. I'm out of breath with all that. I don't know what's going on. We're in a series on being transformed and what that looks like. I just want to take a moment to say, if you're a first-time guest with us, thank you for being here this morning. I'd love to know a little bit more about you. If you'll fill that out on the connection card. If you're a regular attendee, again, fill out that connection card. Let us know what's going on in your life. And we are in this series about being transformed. What does that look like in our life? And my heart, my passion is that through this journey together, that you'll grow to a new spiritual level, that this year will not be another cycle of what last year was. But that if we close 2017, you'll be able to look back and say, hey, I have made some significant life transition. I have watched God show up and do some amazing things in my heart and in my life. And so this week, I want to continue that. And I want us to talk about this morning about being stressed to blessed. How many of you would say you got some stress in your life? Okay, now some of you are honest, but the rest of you, I'm going to preach online next Sunday, so you might want to. How many of you would say you got some stress in your life? Amen? All right, I could have a big t-shirt that says stress. Stress is everywhere we turn. But look at what the scripture says. It says that a relaxed attitude lengthens a man's life, is what how the NLT says. That a relaxed attitude lengthens a man's life. And I will tell you that science has proven that if we live in chronic stress, that it literally shortens our life. Let's talk a little bit about stress. First of all, if we can figure out how to lower the stress and tension and increase the peace and mind of relaxation, if we can do that, we'll live longer, we'll live happier. Now, it's true that we spend a lot of money trying to relieve stress. We go to spas, we get massages, we take vacations. We try to do all these different things to what? To get away so we can relax, so we won't be so stressed. And whenever your body feels stress, there's these responses that go on within your body. There's emotional responses, there's physical responses, spiritual, mental. All these goes on in a moment within your body. Your blood pressure goes up. Your pulse quickens, adrenaline shoots into your blood, and you have all these physiological changes that transpire. Now that's good. This is what God made you. But He made it so that, like, if you're standing in a road and a truck's coming and you see it coming, and all of a sudden you respond and you jump and you get that burst. That adrenaline gives you that extra, your heart rate will go, more blood's going through your body, therefore more oxygen's in your body, and you can respond in a moment. Everything is quickened. But you weren't designed to live in that chronic state of stress. Matter of fact, if you continue to live there, it does significant damage to not only your brain, but also your heart, your lungs, and other parts of your body. And literally, stress can kill you. Stress can kill you. So understand, God doesn't want you to live in a chronic state of stress. Look at your neighbor and say, thank God. Thank God He doesn't want us to live there. So how do we move away from that? How, in our culture today, how do we move away from that? Well, first let's look at some things in our culture that causes stress. Number one is worry. Now, there's going to be some of these come up on lists for you, but I've actually, since I built this and gave it to the guys, I was like a week ahead of them. I've actually tweaked it a little bit, and I added some more because I had some revelation, partly because I walked through some stressful stuff. But anyway, but let me give you some worry. Worry, man, this stuff is bad. I mean, we come to that place, it's the number one thing. We spend time worrying, fretting over it, thinking about what could be and what would happen. Maybe something's going on and we know a problem, but then we start working through scenarios and we just worry and we mull over that problem and we stir it up and we just keep processing and processing it. What about work? Work is another one. You know, we often carry our work home with us, and work is one of those things, and we're worried about the problems, what's going to happen with our job, what's going to happen and if sales decline, what's going to happen if the economy goes a different way. What happens is technology advances. I worked in the printing industry for years and was in customer service, and I watched even in that transition of how when we went from everything being done with four-color film to how everything became digital, and I watched people lose their jobs in that process as technology advances. Maybe you know already on your job where you've seen technology advance. Where is it going to stop? At what point will we no longer need maybe your role or maybe your industry won't need your role? What's going to happen? So we can find some work being very stressful, high pace, high performance, high demand, hard to balance family and faith. And then today we live in a hurry. Anybody live in a hurry? We live at such an increasing pace of life. We want it faster and faster. We live in a microwave nanosecond world. And everybody wants it and they want it now. Bosses will contact you at 2:00 in the morning so you can get up and work on a project for them. People will call you. There's no boundaries any longer. It's about get it done and get it done quick. You know, years ago, people were used to getting something. They were used to living by catalogs. You know, they order something and you'll get it a couple weeks. Not now. Now we want it today. We want it the same day. And sometimes, listen, we will settle for inferior quality just to have it now. I mean, let's be honest. Do chicken McNuggets even equate to grandma's home-style fried chicken? But yet we'll pull into McDonald's and get a 20-pack or 10-piece because we want it now. I'm just saying that there's a huge difference between quality, but we sacrifice that at the sake of convenience. Money is an issue. It seems like the dollar doesn't go as far as it used to. The value of the dollar is down. It's hard to tell your money where to go. It's hard to stay on budget. And I just encourage you, staying on budget is a huge thing. Learn to live within your means. But that's hard to do. We live in a world that we're told by media all the time that our life would be happier if we would invest in this project, if we had this particular item in our home. And if we buy into all that, we're going to live a life constantly unsatisfied, constantly always trying to add stuff to our life to make our life better. And stuff doesn't make it better. If you're not happy before you get stuff, you won't be happy after you get stuff. Then what about crowds? We live in an ever-increasing, growing world. Is it just me, or does it not seem more crowded than it used to be? I mean, it's like, used to people had elbow room, but now it's like you go downtown, even in Brookhaven, and it's like the boulevard's always busy. There's always stuff going on. Listen, 83% of America lives in large cities. Do you realize that? And do you realize that in 1800 there was only one city in the world that was over 1 million people? London, England. And today, there's over 500 cities with a population of over 1 million. We've even created a special term, or our people who work in that area created a special term for these mega cities. Like Mumbai, India, which has over 32 million people. Tokyo, Japan has 36 million people. And Mexico City has 35 million people. Can you even think about those numbers for a moment? That you literally can drive for miles and not see anything but concrete, concrete, and concrete. And anywhere you have more people, you have more traffic. And now we live in a world where we not only are single car homes, we're double car homes, many times three, four car homes. And all those cars on the street, and listen, there is nothing that will stress you like traffic will stress you. Right. You may be more spiritual than I am, but I'm going to tell you, traffic stresses me out. And then you put young drivers on the road, that really stresses me out. I think they quit teaching that book sometimes. I pulled up the other day, let me tell my story. I pulled up the other day at this light, and it was a four-way stop, actually. And this person, they were quite a bit younger than me. I'll just say it that way. And apparently they don't know what four-ways are for, because they didn't even slack up. They just hit it, and if I had not been watching, I mean, they would have parked their little Mitsubishi right in the middle of my truck. And it's just, it's important that we know that traffic can cause stress. Then there's problems. Man, problems will give you something to worry over. Problems are always there. And it's able, problems, we get bombarded by problems. And they may be little problems or big problems. And when you get stressed, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter if you're trying to figure out what you're going to cook tonight. You know, or whether you're trying to figure out how to balance the budget so you can pay that extra medical bill. All that stress causes, all those problems cause stress. And what happens is we can begin to lose focus, and that causes depression in our life. They bring fear and frustration. And can I just tell you, Jesus said this way. He said, know that in this world you're going to have trouble. Jesus didn't promise to take all the problems away. But he said, know this. He said, you're going to have trouble, but be of good cheer. He said, I've overcome the world. And that's what we want to talk about this morning, that victory that you have. What about indecisions? One of the stresses that we have today is not being able to make our mind about what we need. I mean, come on, think about it. Years ago when you was a kid, you didn't even have to think about what toothpaste you got. Number one, your mama just went and bought it, right? But then, think about it. There was like five main brands of toothpaste. Now there's like 50. And within that 50, I mean, you've got all these different versions. You know, do you get extra whitening? Do you get peroxide? Do you get the one that fights cavities? Do you get the one that tastes like bubble gum, or the one that tastes like cinnamon? All these questions. Well, I mean, used to you just went and pick one up. Now you've got to decide. And what are the different ingredients? Are some natural? Some are made with man-made? Just in toothpaste. Think about how our world has shifted and how many different things. Where used to you might have one or two choices, now there's a world of choices. And many people find themselves crippled by all those choices. You know, I just want cough syrup. I don't care. Just give me cough syrup. But you better know. The ingredients change. Do you need one with, Robitussin with DM? Do you need one for your cough? Do you need one with extra mucus relief? What do you need? If you don't know that, and so you got to make up. What about relationships? Relationships bring stress. If you're in a relationship with someone who's emotionally or spiritually unhealthy, that brings stress into your life. Maybe if you're emotionally unhealthy or spiritually unhealthy, sometimes the problem is you. And if it's you, that still brings more stress. And then those, a lot of those that we're in relationship with, we don't actually get to pick them. It's many of those that we're in relationship with, we're born into. And we're born into all the stuff that they have brought along the journey with them. And so many times we're in that makeup and when of parents and homes and kids and siblings. And we need boundaries and we need accountability, but if that's not there, stress comes. And then what about loss? One of the main laws, I know there's grief, we're losing a loved one, whether it's to death or what we was talking about in our G2 group this morning, losing kids to college and so forth. Loss, it can bring a lot of stress into our life. I was just thinking this week about the loss of privacy. How, if you notice that when you go to the store now, it's like somehow they're tracking. They keep they know your credit card, your debit card is attached to your name, and they know you buy this product all the time. And somewhere, some computer somewhere is keeping up with all this stuff that you buy. Walmart tracks everything you buy. That's why I was told by somebody that there was a set number of Walmart products in every store, and then everything else they shift in and out depending on what people are buying. I think it was like it was somewhere around 12,000 standard items that Walmart carried all the time. Everything else has shifted in and out. And it was just crazy that they keep track of that. Amazon's doing it. Everybody's doing it. I mean, they know whether you're buying, they know that you're buying Pampers. And in 40 years, they'll be contacting you to see if you want Depends. We lose this loss of privacy. Then there's opposition. Opposition in our life. Years ago, America was a homogeneous society. That means everybody pretty much believed the same thing, did the same thing, lived their life with the same goals, the same pattern. But now we're this melting pot, this stew, if you would, of people from different backgrounds and different cultures. And where years ago most people came to America to be American, and then they laid down a lot of those beliefs that Christianity was the faith of America, and we were a godly nation. Today there's all these different pursuits of religion, and you can be setting or working with somebody that believes something totally different than you, and sometimes that brings stress because they see life different than you. Their value system is different. The way they handle their life is different than yours, and then. Which brings the conflict, and conflict is a huge part of I don't know anybody that enjoys conflict. Most people dread conflict, and when we see things different, that always leads to conflict, and we have this struggle with conflict. We hate opposition. We hate it when things get difficult. And then there's fear. Fear is a huge stressor. The what ifs, the fear of tomorrow. Fear of the future. Now, last week we looked at the story of the prodigal. This week I want to look at another famous passage of Scripture. I want to look at Psalms 23. I want us to look at a Scripture or chapter that's able to bring a lot of peace in our life. And we often hear it talked about. How we read it for peace and how it can bring peace. But today, I actually want to tie some of the symbolisms and some of the imagery that's in Psalms 23 to these very same fears that we've talked about that we struggle with today. Because see, God wants you healthy. I want to say that one time. God wants you physically, mentally, and emotionally healthy. The Proverbs tells us, Proverbs 14:30 says, peace of mind makes the body healthy. And understand, it's not always what you eat, but sometimes it's what eats you that makes you unhealthy. Sometimes it's what eats you that makes you unhealthy. And God wants you to have a peace of mind. He wants you to have peace of heart. Because God cares about your spiritual health. Let me tell you why He cares about your spiritual health. 3 John chapter 1, verse 2 tells us, Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you. In other words, he says, listen, I want you to live well. I want your life to be well. That you may be in good health and it goes well with your soul. God wants your soul well. He wants your health well. And can I tell you, that means that God cares about your mental and your physical attributes. He cares about this body. He cares about your mental aspects of how you see life. And the first thing you need to know is because you're the property of God. Your body does not belong to you. It belongs to God. Paul writes out this whole dissertation in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. It's not on the screen behind me, but write these notes down, because you go back and read this a little bit later. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12 through 20. And Paul is dealing with some people. He says, not all things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. He says, listen, I can do all things, but listen, I'm only going to do the things in my life that are helpful to me, that actually grow me. He goes on to say, but he said, I will not be dominated by anything. In other words, he said, I'm not going to have any addictions in my life. He goes on to say that food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. The Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord, talking about Jesus Christ, and he will also raise us up by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I then take the member of Christ and make them members of prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her? And he said, listen, when you're engaged in sexual immorality, because you're one with Christ, you're causing the body of Christ to sin, because you're one with God. He goes on, he says, or do you not know that he who is joined, he goes, verse 17, but he who joined the Lord becomes one spirit with him. He goes, flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin that a person commits is outside the body, but sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know, now hear these words, that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? That you are, who is in you and who is from God? Do you not know that you're not your own, for you were bought with a price? So glorify God in your body. You see, you're not your own property. You belong to God. The body that God's given you belongs to him. Now, I know you look in the mirror and say, hey, I am what I am. But listen, sometimes we need to realize that we belong to him. And God expects us to manage this body. He's given us a responsibility to take care of it, to make sure that it's treated well. And one thing we need to remember is that our body one day will be resurrected. Now, I know it's going to be glorified, but somehow the Bible tells us it's going to be something of what we have now. He says, because we're going to have some symmetry to what we look now, because he said, as we're known, we're going to be known. And so, because God's going to raise up some form of this body, we need to make sure that we take care of it. My body is connected with Christ. Just like I read there, you know, we need to understand that when we do something, that somehow, spiritually, we're connected to Christ, and the things that we do have the power to impact our relationship with God and impact our testimony. That our body is connected to Christ. That the Holy Spirit lives in us. And remember that the Holy Spirit lives in you. Remember that when you're speaking to one another. I mean, what you say, you need to remember that every time you talk to somebody, that the Spirit of God resides in them. Would you talk to the Holy Spirit the way you just talked to your wife? Would you talk to the Holy Spirit the way you just talked to your husband? It got quiet. But understand where I'm coming from this morning, because we have to understand the Holy Spirit resides within us. And then think about some of the actions that we often find ourselves doing. It's because we don't realize. You see, we've got to change the way we think. And when we understand the Holy Spirit is in us and working in us and working, then it changes the way we think about what we're doing and how we feel. And we understand that there's more to just satisfying a desire. There's purpose to our life. And then Jesus redeemed this body on the cross. This is the body Jesus died for. He died for you and I. We're called to take care of it. And God cares about that body. That's one part of the reason Jesus went to the cross, was so he could present you before the Lord. So that you and I could have life and have it abundant. And so understand that. That's why Romans tells us to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, a reasonable act of worship. And so God cares about this body. And that's why he gives us these seven spiritual principles that we find here for having peace, to take your stressed life and convert it to a blessed life. The psalmist writes and says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pasture. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Today, let's look at these verses, and as we look at them together, I want to show you some antidote, if you would, some techniques, some habits that we can glean, that we can apply to our life to minimize stress and frustration. And the first thing I want to say that is I think we often stress our greatest stress is over worry. And we worry because we think we have a need. And then many times in that need, we have an expectation for somebody else to meet that need. We think a spouse will meet that need, or a child will meet that need, or a job will meet that need, or a relationship will meet that need. And the reality is, if you're putting any of those, you've got to understand that nobody can meet all your needs. No physical person can go through life with you and never let you down. Amen? Amen? And so you have to realize that maybe some of what you're walking through, some of the worry, the stress you're putting on yourself is because of unreal expectations. Habit number one is that we look for God. We look to God for all our needs. We've got to look to God for all our needs. You see, when I have a need, if I look to Him to meet that need, then when I think about His ability to provide that, I'm able to calm down. But if I just only think about my need and how big it is, and then I'm going to be disappointed. I'm going to have distrust. But God wants me to trust Him for my needs. And if I'm looking to Kim to meet my needs, or if I'm looking for someone else to meet my needs, then what happens is that our stress goes up dramatically. And we have to stop putting our security, hear me this, stop putting our security in things that can be lost. People can be lost. It happens all the time. It's death. It's a natural process. Jobs can be lost. Relationships can be broken. Marriages can dissolve. And if your security is in that, then you're going to be asking yourself, who am I now? Where is my identity is in that other person? And listen, you know, many relationships today are unhealthy relationships. Actually, psychologists do, they're codependent relationships where we think our whole world is evolved around that other person. I want to tell you, that is an unhealthy relationship if you can't go on without that person. And see, we have to look to God to be able to meet that need. And as your pastor, as your friend, I want to recommend to you today that you never put your security in anything that can be taken away from you. Your job, your health, your reputation, your spouse, even your mind, you can lose all those things. But you cannot lose your relationship that you have with God. And if you'll focus on who you are in Christ and the relationship that you have in Him, then regardless of what comes your direction, you won't lose. Look at what the psalmist says. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I have no need. The Lord is my shepherd, and because He's my shepherd, I don't have a need in my life. Romans 8:23 says, He who did not spare even His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also so graciously give us all things? And see, when I stop expecting people to meet my need and I look to God, I know that God is not going to withhold any good thing. He's not going to withhold anything from me that I really need. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that in Romans. He says, listen, if he would even give his own son because he saw the need that you and I have for salvation, how would he withhold any other thing from us? And so today, that's something we've got to grab a hold of, that when we have to look to him to supply our need. You see, the first step in stress reduction is worship. And we begin to give God glory for who he is and that he is the supply. Look at how Isaiah wrote it. He said, the sovereign Lord says, only in returning to me and waiting for me, then your strength will be saved. In quietness and confidence is your strength. He doesn't say in fear and anxiety. He doesn't say in hard work and planning. He doesn't say in self-motivation and positive mental attitude. No. He says in quietness and confidence. And when we wait on God, God is able to bring strength in our time of need, in our time of difficulty, in our time of trouble. And so when we start getting stressed out, we have to start looking to the real source, the one who can really provide. And if you're frustrated with life, maybe you've got your trust in the wrong one. Maybe you're putting expectations on your spouse, on your children, on relationships, on your job, on your health, instead of focusing on the Lord to really be the provider. Habit two that we learn is that we need to obey God's instructions about rest. This is important. Look at what he says. Because we live in this hurry-paced society, and I'm just going to tell you, we work too much. And the reality is, if I was to ask this question, I will. How many of you have stuff to do and you feel like you'll never get caught up? And let me tell you a secret today. You'll never get caught up. There's always going to be something else to add to the list. And so at the end of the day, all we can do is look at God's Word and live and operate in obedience to what His Word tells and speaks to us. And it speaks to us. And God is very intentional about speaking to us about having rest for these bodies. You know, the reality is that, you know, we spend a third of our life in sleep. Now, if God really wanted us to get it all done, why did He build these bodies where they need sleep? Why didn't He just build it where you could go all the time? I mean, come on, you're sleeping through a third of your life. If you only have so many years, why would He give you those years and know that you're going to spend a third of them in sleep? Because He wants us to learn the principle of why we need rest and how things flow out of that rest, so that not only will we physically rest, but we'll also spiritually rest. God wants us to understand the importance of rest. It's so much that He modeled it. You think God really needed to rest on the seventh day after He made heaven and earth? No. He was teaching us because He wanted us to learn the principle. He wanted us to understand that our productivity did not make us or break us. That our productivity doesn't make us successful. Our obedience makes us successful. Got quiet, didn't it? Listen, this is important. He was modeling something that we had to pick up. Matter of fact, did you know that it was so important that He puts it in the big tent? You see, we quote all the time, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not bear faultlessness against thy neighbor. But He said, thou shalt remember the Sabbath day and you shall keep it holy. Preacher, you preach that word. The Sabbath day. Listen, we are called to have a Sabbath. We're called. It's so important. And we often, we sweep that under the rug and we pretend it's not there. And then we even do this number. Sometimes we can over-spiritualize it. And we say, well, that's just so that we take a day and honor the Lord in it. But you know, part of it is that, remember, the Sabbath was just not made. Man wasn't made for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was made for man. What Jesus said. In other words, there is something God wants you to glean out of that Sabbath, and that is rest for this physical body. It's just not communing with Him on the Sabbath. It's also resting this body. And the Bible is filled with instructions about rest and relaxation. Because God doesn't want you burned out. He wants you healthy. And you know, if we're not cautious, we find ourselves working even on our day off. Matter of fact, this afternoon, many of you, instead of going home and resting, you've got yard work you're going to take. You're going to get everything you didn't get done yesterday. And I'm going to tell you, when you do that, you're wrong. You're biblically wrong. Because some of us, we can't slow down and trust that God will help us get the rest of it done. We think it all depends upon ourselves. And I've been there. I've done that. Matter of fact, that's why my Sabbath is not today, because I do so much work on a day like today that I have to take another day and make it a Sabbath. I have to take another day because there's some characteristics that a Sabbath should have in your life. Notice what he says here. And here's where he says, he makes me lie down. I'm going to tell you, if you don't take a Sabbath, the Lord will eventually make you lie down. You know, sheep are not smart. They will keep walking and walking, so the shepherd has to say, hey, stop, and you guys rest. That's why I led you into these green meadows. That's why I brought you beside still water, so you will rest. And some of you, if you're like me, you want to keep going and going because you're going by the list. And listen, the shepherd has to say, time out. And he makes me lie down. I like that word makes there. Because if we don't, he will make us. And I'm telling you that if we don't, eventually your body will make you lie down. That's the way God wired us. See, some of us grew up or we think that we're wasting time if we're relaxing. And you're not wasting time when you're relaxing. You're fulfilling a biblical obligation. Look at your neighbor and say, it's okay that I'm lying. Some of you need to hear that. Listen, Exodus 34. 6 days are set aside for work. How many days are set aside for work?
Six.
Thought so. But every seventh day you must rest completely. Is that completely?
Completely.
Even during your seasons, even during the busy season, even though it's Christmas, I'm supposed to take off. I'm in retail. Even in tax season, it's April. Don't you know it's on the way? Even in farming, don't you know that it's harvest? It may rain tomorrow. I remember my dad worked for a guy one time who was a devout Christian, and it didn't matter. On Sunday, he was off. And it used to kill my dad because my dad grew up hard work. And listen, we've got a window. What happens if it rains? But that guy, I had to honor his faith because he said, listen, if it rains, I'm trusting the Lord. I'm not running those combines on Sunday. And he wouldn't do it. He wouldn't do it. I'm just telling you that even here in the Scripture, he says, even in your seasons of plowing and harvest, you must observe the day of rest. Even your busiest times. I heard about a guy one time that came to this pastor. He couldn't get a hold of him. And he said, hey, preacher. He said, I tried all day trying to get you. And he said, I couldn't get up with you. He said, yeah, that's my day off. He said, well, do you understand Satan doesn't take a day off. He said, yeah, that's probably why he's so mean. And the reality is, if we don't take a day off, we'll get mean. We can only do so much. So what are the markings of a Sabbath day? Because listen, as I share with you, my Sabbath is not on Sunday. I work hard on Sunday. My Sabbath is from Friday. And I don't call it a day off because if you call it a day off, you'll cheat. Sabbath has intentionality. What's the intentionality? Rest for my body. Number one, rest for my body. I have to have physical rest. That means today you need to go home and you need to take a nap this afternoon. You need to physically rest. Refocus. It also means it's okay to sleep in a little bit on Sunday morning. Refocus my spirit. Refocus. That's why worship and fellowship, confessing and praying is so important. It's time for me to connect with those around me. I'm worshiping. And then recharge my emotions. Hey, God, we all recharge every way. What hobbies do you have? I mean, if you like football, that means you can sit in front of football and watch some football on Sunday afternoon. Watch some football. It's recharging you. If you like to read, it means get out a book that you like to read. Find a hobby. But you have to find something that recharges your emotions. I got a lot to, and I've got to move on. I'm sorry. But listen, you've got to find that day. And you've got to learn not to feel guilty for recharging yourself emotionally. Did you know that in the French Revolution, they actually did away with Sabbaths? They did away with any day off. reminds me eerily of our society today. But they had to eventually go back and reinstitute it because of the health of the nation. They found people were literally, they were watching people, the death rates were going up, people were stressed, the crime rate was increasing, all because nobody was having a Sabbath or a day off. It's that important. He causes me to lie down. Number three, you gotta recharge your soul with beauty. Have you ever thought and looked at the world around you and you looked at the creation? You think there's a reason why God did it that way, why he made it so pretty? It's because you're naturally recharged by things that are beautiful. And things that are ugly causes you distress. Don't look at the person next to you. But things that are ugly cause you distress. There's a reason. Listen, you've got to find beauty. How many times have you heard people say, be standing in some natural park and they go, or something majestic, and they go, man, you know, this just makes me feel close to God. That's the way we're wired. Now, there's a reason God hid his beauty in the sunset. There's a reason in the mountains. There's a reason in even the depths of the universe. God displays things with beauty. He could have made it all just gray. He could have made it all look like the moon. But he didn't. I mean, and you know, one of my favorite times of bringing my computer up is to see what will be the scenic shot that it's going to show me of the day. And just sometimes I just stand in awe of the beauty of God. And so, listen, that stuff recharges you. Maybe it's learn every day to get outside. Maybe take a walk. But take some time. Even if it's just 5 or 10 minutes, to take a cup of coffee, to do something and just breathe in God's creation. And then learn to put things in your life that are intentionally remind you of God's beauty. And maybe it's listen to a worship CD. Maybe it's listen to something Christian, look at some Christian art. But there's a lot of stuff. Listen, God wired us where the arts and beauty, they motivate us. And we need that in our life. Maybe it's sitting down and writing. You know, if you're a journaler, if you like, listen, maybe it's just sitting down and pouring out your thoughts on paper. Whatever it is, there's something in you that's meant to create. God's a creator, and he wired you to create. And when you apply that, it brings out that aspect of God out in your life. Well, here's what you need to know. Whatever things are pure, lovely, divine, virtue, and praise, put your mind on those things. Listen. Believe it or not, you don't have to watch everything that comes out of TV. TV's always negative. Listen, if it bleeds, it leads, right? And so, listen, some of you would be better off not watching so much news. And you know, and the reality is that we're in touch with so much news today that many of it doesn't even impact your life. You can do this test. Take and not watch news for a week and see if your world shuts down. It won't. You'll realize that you can live without it. But because of technology, we have every little blurb. And one of the things I had to turn off my phone was the news, because it found out that I read news and it started sending me news blurbs all the time. Listen, I don't need to know that all the time. And because, again, if it bleeds, it bleeds. And it's going to always, 90% of the time, be something negative. Because positive stories don't usually get promo. They get buried somewhere on the back page. It's always some tragedy. Somebody's angry at somebody else. Listen, learn. Whatever you focus your mind on is going to impact you. You got to have something that's going to recharge your spirit, your soul. Learn to go to God for guidance. Learn to go to God for guidance. Listen, if you lack wisdom, the Bible tells us in James, if you lack wisdom, to seek God who gives liberally and does not condemn us. God will always give you what you need at the right time. Now listen, if you're seeking an answer for next year, you don't need that answer yet. God wants to build trust. So he's going to give it to you in the right time. In the right time. God's going to always guide you to his truth in the right time. Get into his word. Spend time in prayer and listen for his voice. Look at what it says in Psalms 23. Verse 3, he guides me in right paths for his name's sake. He guides you in those paths for his glory, for his name's sake. He's going to lead you in the right path. You can trust him, but you've got to be willing to trust him. Trust God in dark places. Notice what it says here. In the valley of darkness, in the valley of darkness. There's some of us walk through some dark places. We talked about grief in our connection, but grief is sometimes a very dark place. And grief is a healthy process that we walk through, but some of us, we don't grieve very well. We actually just stuff down all those feelings and those emotions, and then what happens is that thing winds up consuming us. And we have to stop pushing down pain and walk through those emotions, because it's in those dark valleys that God is able to stretch us and God teaches us to trust Him. And it's in those that grief process that we learn more about God. God doesn't say it's wrong to grieve, but He does say it's wrong to fear. God doesn't want you living your life in fear. And it's easy that if we walk through grief and we don't handle grief correctly, then we wind up beginning to live our life in fear. Matter of fact, do you realize the Bible says not to fear some 365 times? Think about that. One for every day of the week. Every day of the year. Excuse me. Every day of the year. The Psalms, he says this, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Notice our protection is in His rod and His staff. It's in that that He comforts us. He pulls us to the side. And maybe you're walking through a valley. Maybe it's a shadow of death. Maybe it's a shadow of debt. Maybe it's a shadow of depression. Maybe it's a shadow of discouragement. And here's one thing I know about shadows. Shadows are scary. The shadows can hurt you. You know, if I see a truck coming, that truck can hurt me. But if I get hit by a shadow, just a shadow. But I know that shadows always seem bigger than the object that they represent. You need to know that about shadows. They're always bigger than their source. And a lot of times the enemy will use a shadow to cause fear in your life. And God doesn't want you to walk in fear. He wants you to have peace and sound mind. But here's also what I know, that every shadow has a light source. You know what the Bible tells me? I need not focus on the shadow, but I need to focus on the light. He's the light in my salvation. And you need to focus on Him. Trust Him even in those dark places. Psalmist says this in Psalm 142. He says, when my spirit faints within me, you know my ways. He said, Lord, you know the path that I need to go on. Listen, I'm telling you that God knows the direction you need to take in your life, and you can trust Him. The next thing that you have to do is let God be your defender. This is a hard one. Because let me tell you, there are always critics out there to criticize you. It's easier to find a critic than it is to find somebody to cheer you on. And there's always, think about it. And there's always these unmet expectations people have of you. And then when you don't meet those expectations, they find it easy to say things about you. And you're going to always have critics in your life. And they'll rain on your success. They'll rain on whatever God is doing. And the natural response is to fight back. The natural response is to go to battle with it. But listen, learn to let God be your defender. I think the greatest story of that is the story of David. See, hear me. Critics are the least important people in your life. Little people belittle people. That's good enough for right now. Little people belittle people. They reveal the smallness of their dark hearts. Anybody can complain. Anybody can be critical. But great people make you feel great. I want to make people feel great. I want them to know that God's got purpose and plan for their life. You see, David saw that. David saw that. David was anointed king, and for some 17 years he runs. He's not able to be king because he's running from Saul. Saul was out to kill him. And you know what God does? On two different occasions, God puts David in a position where he could actually take Saul's life. But David honored the leadership of that king, even though he was a bad king, so much that he would not take his life. Matter of fact, God made it so easy. One night they're in camp, and they have snuck into Saul's camp, and Saul is sleeping by the fire. And Abishai, one of David's mighty men, he's standing over Saul with a sword, and he says, just nod. You don't even have to do it, David. You don't have to pick up a sword. You just nod. And if David had gave the wrong nod that night, Saul would have been toast.
But David,
no,
don't touch it. David honored the position. Listen, there is something about spiritual authority and leadership. We learn that. And when you learn not to fight your own battles, it seems foolish for us to try to say, wait a minute, you mean, surely I've got to defend myself. Surely I've got to come to my own defense. The Bible tells us to let God become our defense. And when we do that, I'm telling you, there's a supernatural power that takes place. And the very thing that they seed and they sow to destroy you, God will use it to elevate you. He'll use it to bring honor. Learn to rest in God as your defender. I'm going to finish. We see that out of the life of Jesus. But I want to finish with this. We're going to know that God finishes what he starts. He says, surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You see, there's two ways to look at your life. You can look at it when everything's going wrong, or you can look at it and listen, goodness and mercy, they're trying to overtake me. That's literally in the Hebrew. What it means is it's trying to overtake you. You can't outrun goodness and mercy. No matter how fast you run, goodness and mercy, they're going to get you. Now listen, I want goodness and mercy to catch up with me. I want goodness and mercy to take me down. And that's what God says. He says, listen, I'm trusting so much of my shepherd because goodness and mercy, they're coming up behind me. They're going to take me down. I can't outrun God's goodness and mercy. And I want you to understand that God has a place for you and that you can't outrun his goodness and his mercy. You can learn to rest. You know that he's going before you. And every time something goes wrong in your life, you've got to change your viewpoint. Instead of looking at it with fear and anxiety, you need to realize God's got this. God's in this. He's going to make a way. I'm trusting him, and I refuse to let my fear and my anxiety take over. But goodness and mercy, they're on my heels. And I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Jesus said it this way. He said, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. He said, I'm going to give you rest. If you take my yoke upon you, if you'll learn me, you'll be blessed. Can I tell you today that some of us, we're going through life and we're trying to battle this. And we miss the fact that God wants to give us his yoke. You know, I used to read this and I used to think, man, God, why would I? Listen, I got enough stuff to carry without taking part of yours because you're God. You've got a lot of stuff. Why do I want to be yoked, God, with you? Because, God, how can I go through this? But you know, the power of a yoke is that it sheds the load. Instead of one ox having to pull everything, now it's born between two oxen. And the fact is, Jesus is not trying to figure out if he can carry the load. He's got his. Matter of fact, the Bible says that he's already set it, laid it before the Father. He's in victory today. But yet he comes along and he offers us, listen, you know all that stuff you're carrying, Jim? You know all that stuff you're carrying? If you'll bring it to me, if you'll let yoke beside me, you don't have to carry it by yourself. My answer is, well, what is that stuff you're carrying in your life? What's that weight that's been so heavy? Let him carry the load. Let him meet you in that place this morning. And refuse to walk out of this church with him. What's that stress that you've been living in? Because today he's just simply saying, you'll let it go. If you'll trust me, I'll lead you beside still. I'll make you lie down. I'll even prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemy. You can trust me. Can you hear him whispering to you today to trust him? To let go? Why don't you bow your heads with me this morning? Father, today. God, our prayer is simple this morning. And that is this. Teach us to trust you. To trust you with all the areas of our life, God, where we're so tempted to pick it back up. We're so tempted to try to do it our own way. God, today we just declare Lord, I pray this morning, God, we're just going to let it go.
that you'll give us strength, that we can walk in freedom and victory, that we can walk in peace and have rest. God, maybe there's some life changes we need to make, so we partner with your word, so we stand on your promise. Maybe there's some premises we need to take care of this morning. But Father, one thing I pray is that, Lord, that we would lay it down, and we would come underneath your yoke, because your yoke is easy, your burden is light. And you take our heavy load, and you give us strength for the road ahead. Father, today I pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. As our prayer team comes forward this morning, if you would like prayer, they're here. We want to pray with you. We want to partner with you. And I just want to encourage you, hey, as you get ready to come tonight, as we talk about God's grace, make sure you spend some time this afternoon in rest before the Lord. Learn to walk in that Sabbath and watch what God does in your life. And as you honor it, you're going to realize that you're more productive. And what you thought you didn't have time to do, you're going to get stuff done. I promise you, God's going to honor his word. He's going to honor his word. Listen, we love you this morning. I want to pray one more time, Lord. So if you need prayer this morning, these guys are here. We want to pray with you. You need prayer in your body. Physical touch. And when we finish praying, Kim's going to lead us in one last worship set before we release you today. But I want to remember Sister Rosie and several others that are sick. Bob Hill had surgery last Sunday morning. James is down in his back, and maybe you have a need this morning. By the way, why don't you stand to your feet? Let's just go to the Lord in prayer together at the church this morning on behalf of those needs. And when we're praying, if you would like prayer, we're here to pray with you this morning. Father, today we love you. We thank you for your goodness, your grace. It's ours in Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray that you would meet every life in this church. And Father, you're the God that's our salvation, our truth, our hope. And today, Father, we lift up every need, Lord, every physical need. Father, you're the healer, you're Jehovah-Rapha. And God, we pray that by the stripes Jesus bore, that there would be healing manifested in those lives, in those bodies. And God, that you would do powerful works. Father, we thank you for every unspoken request. That God, you're working today. Lord, even though we may not be able to speak out, God, you're moving. And God, we praise you today. And we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.